Journey with Judy. Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
Good morning. Thank you for choosing to journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And the deal is, you just heard it from the opening song, this show is hot. It is absolutely hot. It has been so hot this week. And when it hasn't been hot, it's just been literally pouring out of nowhere. It's like complete stun. And then all of a sudden, it's raining. But anyway, here's the deal. The show is honest, open, and transparent. So I guess I need to make some confessions. So as you know, if you've been journeying with Judy for 6 years running now, I am a control freak. I confess that I really have more of a fear cast than I do a forecast or a faith cast. I am constantly projecting, and it's only in like the last maybe 4 or 5 years that I have learned the power of the spoken word and of visualizing things and how like what you think about you bring about. And so I not only am a control freak, but I'm super insecure. Most people would think when they meet me that it's quite the opposite. And in reality, like, you know, keep your criticisms to yourself, only send compliments my way. I search for them. I seek them out. And if I don't get them, like my daughter will say, stop asking, Mom. They're not just parting with the compliment. So I talk about things more than I be about things. Another confession. I mean, I want to be about stuff, but typically it's easier to talk about it than it is to be about it. So another thing that you may or may not want to know, and this show has always been about giving way too much information about my life, my family, and things that most people don't talk about, never mind on public radio. But one of the things I absolutely love is the fact that I'm getting to get, and it's a get to, a colonoscopy. So most people dread them, and I am so excited about my colonoscopy. And I think I'm excited because I think I'm going to figure out some things that are going on, possibly wrong, maybe just put my mind at ease. But the reality is I've made an appointment for a colonoscopy 5 times now. And so I don't think I talked to the same person 5 times at St. Luke's Hospital, but I know that every time they're hesitant when they call me because they can see that I have canceled the last 4 times. Now, they think I've canceled because I don't want to come, because I don't like it, and because everybody dreads the colonoscopy as much as the dentist. But I, on the other hand, look forward to it. It's like highlighted in my calendar for the first week in October to have this done. And what I had forgotten about is that there's 50 billion questions that they ask you when you call. So as I was heading into an appointment this week, I allowed 5 minutes to schedule that colonoscopy. And instead, I ended up being 15 minutes late because they asked me, literally, when I say 500, I stopped the woman at one point and said, can I just ask like how many questions you've asked me? So she said she'd never counted, but she thinks it's in excess of 50. And here's the deal. If you answered yes to any of the first 50, well, then that just triggers them to ask you a multitude of other questions that have to do with your answering yes. And so she said, the good news is for you, you've answered no to every question. And so at that point, I also needed to confess to her that by question 10, I was no longer listening. I just kept saying no. And so I am going to have a colonoscopy in a few weeks. I have no idea what they know about me, what's true about me, because I tried to answer honestly, but I just got a little distracted. But here's what was crazy. I never even knew how great I was doing with my health, because I literally did get to answer no to many of the questions where I did listen. And so I guess the question is, because you don't know, does that mean it's not true? Does that mean it's non-existent? Does that mean we're all good if we don't recognize that, unless we recognize the issue is you? What do you do? So you're journeying with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. It is hot, honest, open, and transparent. We'll be back.
Yesterday.
All right, so welcome back. You're journeying with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And it is hot. It is honest, open, and transparent. It is me just putting out there these things that if I put them out there, you can no longer use them against me. So somewhere along the line in my adult life, I wish I learned it sooner, but I learned it later, much like my other lessons, that when you can admit that the issue is you, then really people can't use those things against you. So I'm very quick to recognize my shortcomings. And while I realize by the grace of God, he has used so many of those things to be the very platform in which I preach from, right? I get to relate to people who are struggling in ways that I have in the past and was able to get past those things in the past, and ways that I still struggle today that are very relevant to people, regardless of their age or stage of faith or life, right? So one of the things that has become really top of mind for me, or maybe more on my radar than it has been in the past, and a lot of times that's what happens, is, you know, we're oblivious to something because it does not directly affect us, right? It's not something that affects us in our daily life. And so, not that we don't think it exists, but we're just not given a whole lot of time or energy to those kind of things because it doesn't really affect us. And one of the things that I have noticed more in the last 6 months, because it affected one of my kids, is this topic of anxiety. Okay, so I did not realize how often people throw that word around. And so because I've been learning about it, studying about it, researching about, you know, like biblically, like what is the solution to anxiety? If the Bible gives the solution to every problem and the answer to every question, God has got to have spoken on the topic of anxiety. And of course, he does. And of course, it speaks of, you know, being anxious about nothing, no things, zero things. But instead, you know, bring your petitions before God and just trust that, you know, he's going to work it out. That's my paraphrasing of the Bible. I'm Catholic. Can you tell? So, and I know that's somewhere in the Bible. Couldn't tell you where. So, again, just more proof that I'm Catholic. So the reality is, until my kid used the word anxiety, it was, you know, like an unrecognizable thing to me. And so I've noticed that I don't care where I am, people throw that word around. Like they usually say something like, that gives me anxiety, or this gives me anxiety. And we use it so flippantly that I don't know that any of you realize that 1 in 5 people, 43.8 million experience like an anxiety or a situation of anxiety in a given year. 1 in 25, 9.8 million adults have said and stated that substantially anxiety has interfered with their life or limited major areas of their life as a result of anxiety. 1 in 5 13 to 18 year olds have a severe mental disorder, and 16 million people say that they have experienced major depression episodes. So it's a really big deal. If anxiety is this feeling of worry and unease, it's reflected in nervousness about an event that may or may not be certain to you. There's some uncertainty around that event, but there's an imminent outcome that we have decided in our mind is going to take place. And as a result, the following things ensue: fear, panic, angst, agitation, right? But the Word of God says very specifically that we are to have a peace that surpasses understanding, that we are to guard our hearts, and that everything will end up being okay. The question is, when you don't feel okay, when it's not okay, when you don't see the light of day, I just gave you statistics of people who are navigating that. And if last week when I talked about the issue is you, that really just drives home to those people that the issue is them. And I guess what gets me thinking is, as that woman was asking me literally 50 questions, and I was answering no, I wasn't even aware that there are people who obviously are answering yes to those questions and many other questions. And so my attitude of gratitude exponentially increased as a result of answering all of those questions, no, but again, brought back top of mind for me that when these kids, adults, people in general are just throwing around the word anxiety, that many of us are living our life in a feeling of worry and unease, in a state of panic, fear, and angst, and this underlying agitation. And so what I find so fascinating is when I visited where Campbell's going to be going to school in January, which is in Atlanta, I noticed all over the locker room, it had signs. I mean, you couldn't help but notice them. And they talked about mental health, right? My son Carter played football with a young man who just tweeted last week that he is removing himself from football because his mental health is more important. And, you know, I guess to be able to make a stance in the topic of mental health and recognize that it is something that unless we learn about it, that we cannot have an appreciation for it. And the reality is, based on the statistics, it absolutely has got to be affecting somebody we love. And for sure, if not someone we love, somebody we know. And we just got to be thinking about what we're thinking about. So your journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And on the other side of the break, we'll talk about these emotions, these oceans of emotions that we have. What do you do with it? And are they real if you don't let them come to light? Thanks to Greg Kunis for sponsoring the show. We'll be back on the other side of the break.
So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone, stop holding on and just be here. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be here. Just be here.
All right, welcome back. You're journeying with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And I just love that song that Kurt chose coming from the break, reminding us to stop holding on, like stop holding on in order for God to hold on to us, right? Things might seem like they're falling apart, but in God's plan, they will always fall together. They will always fall into place. And I know I believe that's so much easier for other people than I believed it for myself. I believe it for my kids and the people I get to minister to and speak with and coach. I just believe that greatness and godliness lies within them. And sometimes it's just so much harder to see that when, you know, we're looking at ourselves. And so the reality is there are so many people that are struggling with anxiety, right? I'm not sure how those people would define it, but the definition of it has something to do with being uneasy and uncertain, a state of panic and a state of fear, right? And so if fear is the opposite of faith, you know, these people are, you know, checking their fear cast, right, instead of their faith cast. And I know I'm one of those people who does exactly that. But I can honestly say that I can usually get myself out of it, right? So I typically can pray my way out of it, and therefore I believe that you can too, which is a misconception in the case of so many of these people who feel the issue is them, and they cannot get past these feelings that are all-consuming and overwhelming. And even though Scripture says be anxious about nothing, not one thing, not anything, but instead bring your, you know, your prayers in thanksgiving before God, and He'll say yes to the things He wants to say yes to and no to the things that He wants to say no to. But at the end of the day, everything will indeed be okay. But we got this thing, this God-given thing of feeling so profoundly our emotions, right? Our emotions. So we have this thought, and then from that comes a feeling, and then from that comes this emotion or these emotions, and there's oceans of emotions that oftentimes we feel we aren't in control of. Like they take control of us. And so, as a matter of fact, one of my kids said, you know, Mom, you don't understand how frustrating it is to not be, to feel like you're not in control. And of course, if you know anything about my life has been completely out of control. So I don't get it in the way that, you know, one of my kids has described it, but I certainly have, of course, made it my mission to try to understand and how I can best support. And while I'm a big fan of neurofeedback these days as opposed to medicine, which is a brain training thing that has really benefited so many people. And, you know, if anyone wanted to contact me about that, I certainly would speak about it very openly. So it's about training your brain or retraining your brain, meaning you got to think about what you're thinking about. And if the pattern is that you're going to think about this, then the pattern will be, then you're going to feel that. And ultimately, you're going to act out of what started with a thought, became a feeling, and ultimately became an action. And so this thing about our emotions is our emotions are a response to our feelings, right? Emotions either feel good or they feel bad, but they are neither good nor bad. It is the value that we assign to them that makes them such, right? So we've talked about anger in the past. Anger is not bad in and of itself. Scripture says, you know, be angry, but do not let anger get the best of you. Again, a little paraphrasing there. But the reality is, it's what we do with the emotion, whether it hinders us, whether it helps us, whether it works for us, whether it works against us, that really becomes the issue, right? And so one of my favorite psalms, I always say my favorite because once I learn about one, it goes to like, it goes to the favorite zone. So I have a lot of favorite psalms. And one of them is a psalm 139. It's Psalm 139 where this topic of anxiety is directly spoken of and about, right? The solution to anxiety. So I listen to this preacher. I love listening to preachers. I literally listen to preachers. They are the ones who allow me to run for 5 miles on a treadmill because they get me so fired up about Jesus and faith and all the things I want to be doing and aspire to do in my faith life. And they just make it look so simple on a stage of 50 billion people. But this guy was talking specifically about how anxiety starts because we believe we're believing the enemy is outside of us, when really the enemy oftentimes is the inner me. It's the inner me that's saying these things, believing these things, and therefore acting out of things that just aren't true, right? In the moment, they feel so true, but the reality is it is a lie that we have come to believe. So he pointed out that anxiety has I as its center. And I just love that. Like, anxiety has I in the middle. It's about me, myself, and I, right? It's this Trinitarian thing, actually, but going against us, because when we are suffering anxiety, it is oftentimes a result of imbalance. Some of us feel like everything is the most urgent and most important thing. The reality is, anxiety comes from believing that, right? When we can get to a place that this is what matters, but this doesn't, and we stop putting too much weight in the wrong things and the right amount of weight in the right things, there's a really good chance that our anxiety could be lessened, right? So imbalance, lack of proportion between corresponding things, like literally being out of equilibrium. Another thing that causes anxiety is indecision. My friends, indecision is a prison. It is a prison we live in. I've often said we do not need to be behind bars to feel like we are imprisoned, right? I mean, some of us cannot make a decision. Bob and I will literally watch on demand for an entire Saturday evening, never make a decision about what we're going to watch, and therefore we make no decisions. We cannot make a decision about where we are going to dinner. Now, some of you are saying, well, I'm working on some things and I'm taking the... No, you're literally a procrastinator. So don't tell me you're being more thorough. You are being indecisive. My goal for you this week is to make 3 decisions, and they might have 2 letters in them, N-O. If you said no to 3 people, that would be 3 decisions that could change your life and certainly lessen your anxiety, right? When we are in a state of indecision, we very easily go to a paralysis of analysis, right? When we are not making a decision, it just works against us. All right, Kurt's giving me the peace sign, which means I got to give my 2 more minutes. Integrity. When we are lacking integrity, when we are not whole, but divided. We show up as many different people in many different ways based on the situation. That in and of itself will be a cause of anxiety, right? A state of being divided rather than whole. We cannot pray away anxiety when we are living out of integrity, right? And we see that coming out more and more, unfortunately, in many people in our church. Okay, how about intention? Intention, the final I in anxiety. We got to be checking our motives. We got to be checking our intentions. When we are doing things for a purpose outside a godly one or in an attempt to serve other people and have God's will come to pass, we just got to get out of the center. We got to get grateful, and we've got to get out of the center, because otherwise what we do is we keep judging people based on their actions, but we keep judging ourselves based on our intentions. And so if our intention is a specific purpose, a specific objective to achieve an outcome, which is always to glorify God and to be in His will, it will absolutely lessen anxiety. And so, Kurt, I guess I got to go. You tell me I got to go now. Okay. Thanks for journeying with Judy this week. Keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. And for all past shows, you can go to judyhehr.com, J-U-D-Y-H-E-H-R.com, where you will find every show that I have done for the last 6 years, thanks to Cunis Country Auto Group. You've journeyed with Judy, and keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. Peace out.